in my life at this time, I am so happy to be in Christ and to be obedient to the will of God for my life. I wasn't always there. But if God took to my life, I had to help him. I know I ain't going no more. I mean, we have to pay for it. You know, you look at Abraham, 25 years for a promise. I mean, come on now. 25 years for a promise? God can take it too long. You know, you couldn't have told me I had to wait 11 years to get married again. Matthew 16 and 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. Others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Shall be loosed in heaven." Then charged his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again on the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee." But he turned and he said unto Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savest not the things that be of God, but those that be of man." You may be seated.
Preach,
all right.
Whom do men say that I am? What are people saying to you about who Jesus is? Because I'm sure it's way worse now than it was back then. Because you got atheists on the uprising, you got homosexuals on the uprising, you got everybody's got their opinion. And everybody's got their thoughts of how it's going to go and how it's going to be and how it operates and functions. Amen? And all of that's against God. And so, of course, it's going to be on the uprise because he told you what? It's going to be a great what? We see it. Look around you.
Yeah.
We're not the only church, but there's a lot of churches this morning that are quite kind of empty because there is a great falling away.
That's right.
I mean, you count the millions and trillions of people that's in the world, and then you count the the few thousands that do come to church.
All right.
There's a great falling away.
Yeah.
It's no secret. When you're on your job and you're in your marketplace, and you see people talking about Jesus, not too often. Secret type thing. Secret salvation.
Yeah.
I mean, when I first got saved, man, we used to tell everybody, man, the churches, they were full, they were packed, people were coming everywhere. among the pews, and you know, sheep beget sheep. You know, a pastor shouldn't be out there. I mean, he does, but that's not his only job. It's up to us too. God charged that to us.
Yeah.
Go to the highways and byways and compel them to come.
Yeah.
That was a charge to the church. That wasn't to the pastor.
Yeah.
That was to everybody.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Who do men say that I am? Some of them say you're a prophet. Some of them say you're Elijah. Some of them say you're Jeremiah. And you know why people would say that? They would say that because they've seen prophets. They've seen Elijah. They see these men and women of God do great exploits and everything else, but they never had to answer to them. You see what I'm saying? You didn't have to answer to Jeremiah because he was pointing to the Lord. You didn't have to answer to John. He was pointing to God. And everybody that spoke and did what they were pointing to God. But when Jesus came on the scene, professing to be God, that's what the prophets are.
Yes.
We ain't got to answer to the prophets because they're prophets. And they're pointing us to who we got to answer to. But this guy now is coming to say, he's God in the flesh. No longer are we pointing to say, but you got to answer to his dad, his father. And he's coming to say, I'm his son. And I'm giving a direct message to you. I came from heaven to deliver to you what my daddy said, what my daddy's like. See, we had no idea how God was like. And we know him to be Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Tissue. We knew all those things, but we didn't know how he operated and functioned in the flesh. He came down to be flesh to show us how to control his flesh. See, for this purpose, he was manifest.
Get
back in my word.
That's it.
that's not natural that you normally wouldn't do.
Yes.
Lack of consecration, lack of dedication, lack of communication with God. Who do you say that is?
Oh, yes.
It's difference.
Yes.
You got to know that.
Yes,
he says, Peter asked him, he says, thou art the Son of God, Son of the living God, the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
He says, Simon Bar Jonas, you're blessed. But my Father, which is in heaven. Powerful statement. Flesh and blood, that means what you can see, what you can think, what you can feel. My mind, my will, my emotions. Where we've been operating all our life. Without Christ, that's what you operate in, is your mind, your will, and your emotions.
Yeah, that's right.
But he had to come show us. He said, it's more to this thing than your mind, your will, and your emotions. I'm going to show you how to not operate in your mind, your will, and your emotions. See, that's why he had to come. Remember I said spirit? Remember I said spirit? He said, flesh and blood didn't reveal that because he couldn't reveal it to us. If flesh and blood could have revealed it to us, it wouldn't have been revealed to us without Christ. Am I right? If it would have been revealed to us, he said, flesh and blood didn't reveal it to you. He said, my Father in heaven revealed it to you. How did Jesus know that? Because everything was downloaded through the Father to him. And then he said that we can do the same thing that he did, so everything should be downloaded to us through the Father. When you're filled with the Holy Ghost, you have the advantage. If you allow him to do it, It's more than just coming here sitting looking at me or looking at who's ever up here and then going back the same way. He came to change your life. He came to change you from living flesh to blood to spirit. When he said, I come to give you life and life more abundantly, he's talking about the spiritual life. When you walk in the spirit and receive the things of the spirit, you are living more abundantly. It disciplines you. It disciplines you. It brings a voice that needs to be heard and needs to be obeyed.
Yes.
Usually when he's talking, you're in an area where you shouldn't be.
That's right.
Remember when he talked to Isaiah? What he said? I'm amongst people with unclean lips.
Yeah.
Nobody would have known that.
Yeah.
But God knew it.
Yeah.
And he sent his spirit, a great move of God, shook those doors and touched his tongue. And he says, I'm clean. And it's something about when you get clean.
Yeah.
You want everybody else to be clean. Once you get clean, that's your job.
Yes.
Draw or run away. Because everybody ain't gonna want it.
That's right.
Not everybody.
That's the truth.
There's some remnants. God always has remnants.
Yes.
Somebody else.
Yeah.
Preach.
Who do you say he is?
Yeah.
Who do you say that he is?
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Which means rock. And upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Even though it looks like it, it's not prevailing. In the end, I read the end of the chapter of the last book, Revelation. I cheated.
Yeah.
Went to the end.
All right.
End of the book. I cheated.
We win.
It was Peter's confession that he was Christ, the Son of the living God. And he built his church off of that confession. How many know that you got to look into some rock to get a strong foundation? I'm just talking about naturally now. I'm in construction, and boy, sometimes they got to go deep.
They do. Yes, they do.
You got to go real deep to connect to some rock for your foundation. And the deeper you go, the stronger the foundation.
That's right.
A lot of times, the higher up they go, the further down they gotta go. Because you gotta have support on the bottom to hold what's ever on the top.
That's right.
And I'm saying to you, powerful living, the reason why we have such a strong, powerful ministry team is our foundation.
Yeah.
I got it,
yeah.
And I don't call that church grow. All I call that is revolving door.
Yeah.
Amen. Because that's what's going on.
Yeah.
Soon as one falls, they'll run and find another.
Yeah.
And make it don't care what they call it. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
but you have the power.
Yeah.
You've heard of it. One man came coming through the city, hit one house, jump over another. Why did you jump? He bounded.
Yeah.
That's all you got to do, but you got to be real with God, and then he'll allow you to possess that type of power.
Yeah.
He ain't going to give it to no idiot.
All right.
He ain't going to give it to nobody that don't know what to do with it.
All right.
Want to make a show of it to bring in more money.
All right. Yeah. Thank the Lord, God.
He ain't going to give that just to anybody. And I know you was right on when you said the anointing breaks to your power.
Yeah.
It's what we were raised on. It's the only thing in these last and evil days that's going to exist and going to stand up when all this crazy. This, you know what? It's going to get worse before it gets better. I'm just here to let you know. You think that tragedy with 100 other men that get shot, somebody in their mind, the enemy tells me you can get more than that.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
You can do worse than that.
Yeah.
Promise somebody right now to do what it was.
Yeah.
And you're going to tell me you don't need to pray. And you gonna tell me you don't need to bind and loose?
Yeah.
Even the storms come.
Yeah.
That storm wrecked Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
Tow it up.
Yeah.
All the way.
You can't tell me this stuff is happening, and he hasn't given us power and authority over for us not to do nothing.
Yeah.
Amen.
I forget which book it was reading, but there was this little church, and none of these people that were gonna come and do something. But the church was so illuminated and so bright, they had sisters in their prayer that they went and up.
Glory! Hallelujah!
Ain't gonna, can't touch this. You know what I'm saying? Can't touch it.
Yes, will do.
And that's the kind of things that I'm talking about. When you know him, you possess that power. When the enemy comes in, you just look at him and say, in the name of Jesus, I will rebuke you. That's going to win. And I already know they're going to win. How many of them? the for sure thing. Knowing. Do you know Jesus?
Yes.
Do you know him? What brought me to this place? I told myself, you've been walking with God over 30-some years. God's done some amazing things to you. God's been good to you.
Yes.
It's about time for me to give him everything I got that's left in me.
Oh, yes.
And I told the Lord, I don't have a problem with that.
Yes.
No more struggle, no more fight, God. I'm delivered. When you're delivered, you're delivered. You know you're delivered when you can go back to the stuff and not do it no more. That's when you know you're delivered. You're not delivered when you come here and you feel good and you get a touch and you go right back and you fail the test. You're not delivered. You're delivered when you get touched. And that same touch that you got here, when you go home, you begin to get your word. Because that's where it's got to go. You got to do something to keep what you got. You can't just come here week to week and possibly Tuesday night or Wednesday night Bible study and think that that's going to keep you. It's not. The relationship that he's talking about is daily. Daily prayer, daily reading the word. Daily prayer, daily reading the word. Daily prayer, daily. And guess what? You get better at it. And it gets good to you. Sometimes I just start out reading and then he just takes me. I'm gone. I'm out. I'm out. I'm gone. I'm caught up. It gets so good to me. And there's nothing like the touch of God, man. Oh my God. Once he touched your spirit and tickle you, I call it God's tickle. He ain't gonna never say he messed you up with that.
Yeah.
He messed me up with that. Once he tickle you, oh my God, he messed me up. He messed me up. But I told him, I said, Lord, I'm gonna be dedicated and committed till I die.
Yeah.
And the reason for that, because I'm going to benefit from it.
Yeah.
I'm going to benefit from it.
That's it.
And since I know I'm on the winning side, anything you give me, I'm going to win it.
Yeah.
And so, why the struggle?
Yeah.
Why are we doubting God when he talks to us?
Yeah.
Why are we giving him a problem?
Yeah.
Don't you know he knows what he's talking about by now? Getting day of Pentecost, what an altar call. But it only happened after they got filled with the Holy Ghost. When they were mere disciples, and when he was here, they operated out of the flesh. They operated out of flesh and blood. They didn't understand a lot of things Jesus said unless the Spirit revealed it to them. But now the Spirit lives inside them. That same Jesus is now living on the inside. We don't have to connect flesh to flesh, but we can connect Spirit to Spirit. The same Jesus that walked with them, the same Jesus that helped them out, is now on the inside. He ain't over there where I gotta go over there and talk to him. I gotta talk to him right here. That's where the power is.
Yes.
You got the Holy Ghost and you ain't spoken in tongues in the last 10 days. You should be doing it every day. Why? Because it tells us that it builds us up.
Yes.
It builds you up. It edifies you.
Yes,
if you ain't done it today, you need to.
Yes.
You need to do it every day.
That's it.
Yes.
Paul said he didn't want everybody. Look at how much. Look at the book that he wrote. And he was in trench, I mean he was in something. It wasn't very much time that Paul went in something. But he was in constant fellowship with God. Dang.
Thank you.
Church. My. I don't think I can say it any plainer. I don't think I can make it any plainer. We need to do better. We do. Even cool to me.
Yeah.
Believe me, when it came to me, it came to me first.
Yeah.
It comes to the preacher first.
Amen.
And I had to say, oh Lord, I'm sorry. Help me. Help me. Help me get back. Help me get back, God. That desire.
Yes.
God, give it to me again.
Yes, Lord.
Who can I help today?
That's it.
Who can I help today?
Yes.
Just need one.
That's
all. Just need one. Who needs to hear your word? Who's hurting?
Yes.
Somebody's hurting you today.
Yes.
I can feel you. But if you don't come, you can't get the help.
Yes.
And whatever you're dealing with is not shameful because it's common to man. We all, somebody here has dealt with it before.
Yes.
You ain't the only one. Somebody's been delivered. From what you're going through. And they can help you.
Yeah.
Come to Jesus.
Lord, yeah.
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus.
Lord, Jesus.
Come to Jesus. All standing. Come to Jesus. All standing. Come to Jesus. He will help you.
Yes.
He will help you.
Yes.
Come to Jesus. I promise you he will. Come to Jesus.
They went there to die. They went there. church, I've been tired of it. You got to make a decision. Now, you're leaving here today, and every Sunday that I can, you'll either leave here knowing that you could go to hell if you walk out these doors, or you can go to heaven, but the choice is yours. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, I want to personally tell you, you're on your way to hell. I want that to be clear. But if you accept him as your personal Savior, you can be on your way to heaven for eternal life no matter what happens to you.
Yeah.
If you left here and had an accident and died, you will be in heaven with God for eternity. But if you don't know him as your personal Savior and you leave here and die, you will be in eternity for hell. And there's no way out. So I'm going to ask you once again, I want you to think right now. It's your decision. Where do I want to spend eternity? See, you can't be straddled a fence. You can't have one foot. I kind of like you, God, but I kind of want to do what I want to do. It don't work like that. So right now, where do you want to spend eternity? And if you want to spend eternity with Jesus, you want to be sure about that, and you want to know who he is, I want you to come right now. And if you want to reject him, I can't do nothing about it. But I need to make it sure. If you don't know him as your personal Savior, then you need to come. You need to come. If you doubt whether you're this day, if you are doubting, am I really saved? Will I really spend eternity with Jesus? Then don't wonder about it. You need to come. You need to come. Father, in the name of Jesus, if there's one soul out there, God, that's wanting to come, but they're having a battle, that Satan is battling their mind, God, I bind the works of the enemy. Come on, plead the blood. I plead the blood of Jesus. That Satan